I would like to thank the Eccles Foundation for their generous and continuous support of this program, Professor of Economics, Dr. David Berry, and the Provost Office for making this event possible. I would like to remind you that today's conversation will continue on the Eccles A.P.E.X Radio Hour podcast, which is available wherever you get your podcasts. Meghan Chayka is co-founder and CEO of Stathletes, a hockey data and analytics company. Stathletes provides industry-leading hockey insights in over 22 leagues worldwide and has scaled to the highest professional levels across North America and Europe. In another industry role, she is a data scientist in residence at the Rotman School of Management at the University of Toronto. She was featured on the insert cover of the Hockey News Top 100 of Power and Influence, listed at 95 overall, and in the top 10 for hockey business executives. Meghan and Stathletes has also been awarded Top Young Entrepreneur of the Year for 2018-2019 by the Ontario Chamber of Commerce and Top 40 Under 40 in Hockey for The Athletic in 2019 and 2020. She is on the board of advisors of U.S. Integrity in the sports betting space. After her presentation, there'll be a short Q&A. We'll bring a microphone up here in front to make it easier to hear your questions. It is now my pleasure to welcome Meghan Chayka to Southern Utah University and to the Eccles A.P.E.X stage.
Wonderful. It is so nice to see everyone here. I hope the title didn't scare anyone away if we don't have hockey fans, but I just want to say thank you so much for the coordination. I visit a lot of universities, a lot of different companies, and I haven't had the warm reception and the wonderful acquaintances and now possibly future people that I have met that I can keep in touch with. So you really are at a special institution. And I just want to thank David, Ryan, and everyone here who has made it really special for me so far. I'm here to talk about a little bit about my journey. I'm going to tie in some hockey, but you could sub that out with any sport that you love. And essentially, I fall in the two kind of categories of sports and tech. I know I run a data visualization company and this is the best I could come up with. But I want to make it very clear. I don't really have one thing that I'm good at. I think if anyone's read the book Range, right, there's a wide variety of disciplines that go into building analytics companies in data, in sports, in all of these emerging categories. So I hope you learn a little bit, you take away a little bit of tips for your own career. And if you're students, I had no clue that I would be where I am right now. So your career is out there. Just chase down what you're good at and what you're passionate about. And you too can join a couple sectors that are traditionally very far apart. So I'm Canadian. I'm from Toronto. I have about 130 employees. And we're pretty humble. So I'm just going to play a video that gives you a bit of my background instead of me have to tell you exactly what I do.
He is at the cutting edge of analytics.
The co-founder and co-CEO of Stathletes.
We say hello to Meghan Chayka.
Meghan Chayka.
It's Meghan Chayka.
So we built software applications to basically like track on ice performance. So when there's movement, when there's events, we know what those events are. They're put into a database and then they can be recalled in various ways. So we try to track as much data as possible. Analytics can be used in a wide variety of ways in player development and especially bringing it back to tools that players are used to working with. So we're talking about video, we're talking about talking their language, not just talking about statistics.
There's a couple of great horses. The front runner Clayton looks awesome, but I'm going to go with Curlin's Voyage at 5-2.
I'm also putting my Bucks on the Bucks in game two. I think we'll see that regression to the mean with the threes. So expected effective field goal percentage won't be the worst of a season for the Bucks. Look for a big win. Milwaukee on the money line in game two, and I'm also taking the under.
We have a wide variety of clients, anywhere from the NHL as a league to Stanley Cup winning teams, the best players in the world, some of your favorite players. They actually really want to get better.
So period one is clearly Montreal's strongest period in goal differential. They have to come out big to start game five. Stay out of the box, stay disciplined, come out like it's the end of the season, because it might be.
They are first in points in the paint, fast break points, and second chance points. So maybe a prop bet on a Grizzlies player is interesting in this series.
Oh, coming from Ontario, we talk about two things, the weather and the Toronto Maple Leafs.
It's true.
I'm on the Leafs right now. You know, they lead the league in possession time per game, playing a strong puck possession style this year in what projects to be the division of death, a very deep and tough division in the East. They have had great goal results, but more importantly, strong underlying scoring chance data to back it up. When you look at the all the
And so that's just a little bit of my media background. And you can see I do such a wide variety of work, whether that's just connecting people to ideas or connecting them to statistics, which historically you've turned on TV and people really didn't want to learn about math. And I get it, right? It's not necessarily the funnest subject sometimes to do formulas and back up your work. But there's some power in understanding how people perform, how companies perform. And this market has, you know, emerged so incredibly in the last 5 years that I think if you're not taking a technical subject right now, you should look into like auditing some courses, because whether you're in hospitality or you're in sports or you're in economics or you're in the arts, there's always some underlying decision-making criterion that having data, having models, and knowing how to deliver that to key decision makers will put you in that like very niche industry where you can be, you could call it the Rosetta Stone, the translation mechanism between math, stats, engineering, to business, to the people that are making these decisions in major companies now. So there I am on the cover of this hockey news. I know what you're thinking. They didn't tell me that they were all wearing navy suits. There I am in a black suit. In my defense, I was in Germany, so I didn't know what they were wearing, but you can see that, you know, some of these industries are largely undisrupted, right? They have a certain cadence, they hire to a certain staff, people that work in it long-term. So my expertise was different. It was unique. It came outside of the norm of what they would expect in sports and especially in hockey. So using that to my advantage and thinking of how I could think differently, how I could build tools to help them do their job better, it wasn't like, hey, I'm going to take your work. It was like, I am going to make your time more valuable, automate certain processes that are taking you a long time now, and make you be able to do your job better. So I always say to students, don't think like, hey, I want this job. Think, how can I make that person better? Because those are always the people that are not only hired, they're promoted. This is another one of a great moment that I had. Moneyball to Homerball. I did this panel. That's Bill James, which is one of like the OGs original that wrote about Moneyball and baseball. He was actually publishing in the 70s on sports analytics, on using data in baseball. And people were like, is this useful? Do we really need this? Is he, you know, will this ever be a sector? I believe it's the 16th or 17th year that the MIT sells out a sports analytics conference. And there I was on the panel with Bill James and Tom Tango from the MLB. And I also had the New York Times artist do a little cartoon of me. So that was a bit of a bucket list moment to feel like not only have I made it, but I feel like the sector really has grown to the mainstream where it's not only accepted, it's wanted. You need some sort of analytics, a way to understand decision making, not just on the performance side, but the business side. So I'm sure you've all, who's bought tickets lately, whether it's sports, whether it's a concert, did you look at the price and go, wow, tickets are very expensive, or these artists are demanding a lot? Well, there's so many ways now that they price tickets, right? And dynamic pricing to different areas, VIP packages, different ways to enter the stadium. And those are all based on data analytics work and people that look at how people are walking into the stadium, how they're engaging with artists, where they can drive more value for the overall sales. So if you see that change in the near future, whether it gets more or less expensive, you know that there's some analytics behind that decision and they want to make it better for like the attendees and then also for the show as a whole. Now, I usually get asked, and I assumed maybe one of the questions at the end would be, how does it feel like being in a woman in sports? How does it feel like in tech? And I would say equally, it's hard. But I would say the first thing that I usually think is really appropriate and kind of like a way to, you know, get past it is you acknowledge it, right? I'm a woman in tech, which is very male dominated, a woman in sport, which is also very male dominated, both on the field and in front offices. So just understanding like, hey, yes, I'm a woman. There's a lot of men in this room, but like that's something we can all acknowledge. And then after 5 minutes, it's a non-issue, right? Business is business. Your degrees right now, things you're taking in school, they're a universal language. And providing value, working with teams, working towards big goals, being able to manage projects, all of those skills, it doesn't matter your gender, it just matters your aptitude. So saying, yes, I may be outside the norm, but I'm here and I have the skills and I'm ready to get dirty and dig my hands in and do the work, I think that's valued anywhere you are. Also, look for those patterns. So look at who is mentor, mentee, how you can be within that pipeline, because you want to align with other people that are not only going to help you, but that you're going to grow and develop and reach your goals. And be forthright too. I always tell people, we can't read your minds, whether that's my employees, people I mentor. You have to ask for what you want, and you have to be even very understanding of what your goals are. So I'd say everyone in the room who's here today, you know, write out your 1-year goals, write out your 5-year goals, write out your 10-year goals. You know, you call it the happy path. If everything goes right, where are you in 1 year? Where are you in 5 years? And what are your backup plans? What do you do in your spare time when you're sitting at home and you're just having fun? Are you like looking at fashion magazines? Are you reading books? Are you consuming, you know, films? There's all sorts of people that don't think that they can have their dream careers because they'll say, yeah, I love films, but I'll never work in it. And my question is, why not? Right? There's huge industries of all of these different types of areas that you can plug your skill set in. And for me, I just happened to get into sports because there was a need and I had developed my skills enough, but I developed them in other industries. I had different degrees, economics, finance, took a lot of math and stats. And I really thought I was going to go into finance, maybe investment banking, maybe into the corporate sector. Worked for 3 years in a Fortune 500 company. Never was it on my radar that I could join that. So as a student, someone that maybe is early in your career, keep thinking of that. Do an audit of your life, where you spend time, what you love, and how to join your skills that you're doing right now to that. I would also say trust your gut. I think there's a huge ability to know when to say no or when to leave. And that differentiates people even more, I would say, than what you say yes to and what you do and what you stick around for. There's a time and place to dig in, to be a team player, to help people along, but be true to yourself and know when that environment doesn't work for you. And I think that's an added layer being a woman, whether you're in tech, sports, you know, large enterprises, to know if you've reached the capacity of you where you can grow and how to find other groups or have another career path that can take you to some place that you're very happy in and that you can continue to improve your career. So that was a little bit of a long-winded way to getting back to Stathletes, but you know, my career was nonlinear. You know, starting this company, I thought, well, we'll just collect data, we'll automate some of the process. Never really thought that we would be an international company, that we would have such a large staff. We work with leagues, teams, like you heard in the video, players, sports books, media. So if you've ever consumed any sort of sports media, you've probably seen one of my numbers at one or another time, or visuals. And we do that through a wide variety of ways. So any analytics company probably does one of these pillars. We do all of them, collecting data, storing data, transforming data, and then figuring out how that action piece. And I think that's a piece where if you are in the arts or you are in sort of a discipline outside of the technical space, you can always focus on that, because that translation, that communication is critical, right? You can do all the best data work, have a JSON that looks like this, and you give it to an end decision maker and they say, what next? These are just numbers. These are just, you know, a way to query a database. I want to know how to action that. So taking it from, you know, raw data to maybe data points. So here's an example, shots from the slot, to some sort of analytics or insights. So these are the best expected goals from those shots, a calculation that values like the quality of the shots. There's so many layers in this sector and so many ways to work with data that I think is really interesting, and not only just in sports. So if you see any like Teslas or self-driving cars or security, a lot of the same processes and the same type of like vision processing is used in a wide variety of ways, and I think only will be continued to be mass adopted as it becomes easier to work with. You know, there's more self-driving cars, there's more ways to monitor, whether it's us in our homes or at, you know, major corporations. They're just throwing a lot of money into this sector to figure out really complex problems. But then we can borrow it in sports and use some of those unique areas. So here's some examples so you get your head wrapped around of how a bit of vision works. You can see in this example, it's following the players. So when people are like, how do you know where people are on the ice? Do you have to go and like put dots or work in Excel? No, there's a lot of software you can build now. And for example, in some of like the more high touch areas, like a self-driving car, you have to be really specific, right? You don't want them to make a mistake That's a big problem. You know, you don't want them to run over a deer, let's say. Whereas in my case, it's hockey. It's not even on the player. If I get it wrong where the player is, I can just figure out what that algorithm is or go back to my engineers and figure out how to tweak that model a bit better. But essentially, it can be hands-off software that's run and collect that data of where all these players are on the ice and used to then understand, you know, decision-making and plugged into bigger models too for like optimization and predictive models. As well, how do we know where they're on the rink? The great thing about sports is there's rules. You know where they are. You know when they play, when they stop and start. Life is obviously a little bit more complex. So those companies that are trying to do health data, they're tracking, you know, finances. There's a lot of intricacies. Sports is actually quite easy. As much as, you know, I or we like in the industry to think, oh, it's very difficult. We know the rules. We know where they are. We know when they stop and start. And we know the constraints. The problem with hockey is there's some, you know, white ice, white jerseys, there's boards, you play it indoors. So some of the other sports like soccer, where you have a running human, a little bit more simple to have some computer vision models that understand running humans than this sort of skating way. But you can see the overlay that the software already knows where the lines are, it knows different landmarks, and is able to understand and detect doesn't matter what rink you put it in. So it's pretty cool how you can like plug and play and use software at scale. And this is putting it all together. So when you see the whole play, you can see there it's understanding where the landmarks are. It's called tomography. And then it also understands where the location is of the players. And it dovetails right into their joints. So it knows how they're skating. It identifies the players. It's pretty cool technology when you really think about it, how far we've come into understanding humans. And this, as I said, can be applied in so many different sectors. And I don't foresee this slowing down in terms of the application. And then you can go from 2D to 3D. So you have a 3D video, and then there's 2D of where they're skating. So there's the clip of them actually playing a game. And then there's the clip of how they're skating. So I can totally recreate the game. So whether that's second screens, whether that's for fan engagement, maybe you do want to watch sports in real life and do the old school thing. But I think there's a lot of a movement of how can you clip and understand sports in different ways? Whether you're just like a GM that wants to be a sideline GM, so you're just a person that plays fantasy and wants to see it this way, or you just want, you know, you're out for dinner and you still want to watch the game a little bit and you want to see that replay in a different 2D model, there you go. Very easy to automate. Then we also do a lot of research. So I figured I'd just throw up this slide because I'm in an institution. If anyone is interested in obviously like graduate school, we work with a lot of postdocs, graduate students and professors to come up with the best way to automate hockey. And if this is up, you can like check out our journals and different things that we've collaborated with universities in Canada to figure out how to like automate these specific areas and use computer vision and other tools to make the process of what we're trying to track a lot better. And that's the biggest challenge in any sort of analytics too, is efficiency, accuracy, and speed. And marrying all those three, there's always triggers where one becomes more or less hard. So you can see it's a little bit fuzzy on these, but they're trying to figure out all the locations of different areas and different players. Now, tips on the dip. This is one I like to talk about a lot because I think all of what I presented so far and all of my awards have come with a lot of setbacks. I always feel like it's, you know, three steps forward, two back. But the great thing is when you're taking three steps forward, you still have one as a differential. You're still moving forward. So I get asked very often, like, how do you deal with failure? How do you come out of no's? And my answer is I get no's all the time, whether that's internally with staff, whether that's with clients, whether that's even with myself, right? I have this like blue sky vision of what I want for my life, what I want for our company, and what I think we can accomplish. And it's not always the easiest path. There's constraints of capital, resources, buy-in, sales, all of that that comes into entrepreneurship that I didn't touch on, but you know, can really interrupt certain areas of progress. So I think for everyone here, it's just like getting comfortable with the setbacks. Your first no is probably the hardest. And I would say if you can and you have any sort of capacity to be in a sales role, it is the best. Everything in life is selling. I'm selling myself right now. I'm selling my company. Even when I'm talking to people, right? I get into an elevator and I'm like, wow, this is so-and-so. I have 30 seconds to tell him something that's maybe valuable to both of us. Queuing that up and knowing what's my like 10, 20 second pitch. You know, when they ask, what do you do? How do I tell them? How do I get, you know, the other party to understand very quickly and easily? And a lot of times you use sort of like catchphrases, right? So you'll always hear in tech, what's your company? And I'll usually say it's like, you know, Moneyball for hockey. Or like someone will say, oh, I'm doing Uber for cats. And I'm like, yeah, it's a great idea. But like, you know, what's more behind it? But I'd say like, come up with who you are and what your brand is. And whether it's a company, whether you're just selling yourself, get comfortable with the uncomfortable and know that there's no, it's just not yet. And your path might not be straight to that yes, but like you can get to anywhere with different ways. You know, all paths lead to Rome. I totally believe that in life. And most likely your job that you're doing in 20 years is not even invented yet. And I think that's a great thing with technology is we really don't know the future, but we can build towards what we want to accomplish. That gets me to the power of media as well. I actually had this lecture. It was 10 years ago. From a very prevalent, actually he's on national TV in the US, very popular now. I won't drop his name because it's sometimes a contentious person, but his feedback was get on TV, be very comfortable with like promoting yourself, people knowing who you are and talking about that. And I was like, I will never do TV. I've done 8 years of university. I love what I do. I am an introvert. I don't like necessarily ruffling feathers. It's hard for me to talk to people. But then I realized that, yes, it's a sounding board. If you can do media, if you can figure out like what your niche is. I did a wonderful radio show, and I'll say Paul and the whole group that coordinated that was awesome. So please listen to it because I even have some of my favorite songs in it. But that just goes somewhere, right? And even if you only touch one or two people in that, there's that spiderweb approach that someone has engaged with you. Someone understands what you're doing a little bit more. So if you are interested in doing YouTube videos, there's YouTube Short now, you know, TikTok, doesn't really matter the platform, but it matters the authenticity, the content, and what you want to do. I'd say for an entrepreneur, you want to be a bit more mindful of what that looks like, and especially if you want to be in a corporate job. But there's so many people that are hyper successful in social media now that know their niche, that are like cooking, you know, and breaking down what they cook. And I'm like, I'm an awful cooker. Like I burnt making eggs and butter at one time. I was like throwing the water on it. My brother-in-law is a fire captain. It was just embarrassing, you know, giving me tips on how to put out this grease fire. But I'm like now watching these like cooking videos on TikTok. And of course the algorithm knows and it's like giving me more. And I'm invested in these people's lives. So I would say, you know, when you're thinking of media, taking that complexity, whether you're making something that's very grand or making something from scratch, or you're doing sports media, how do you talk to the average person about what you're passionate about and what your topic is? Then attention spans, as I'm touching on, right? I'm watching YouTube Shorts, I'm watching these TikToks of a minute that someone's making bread from scratch. And I'm thinking, yeah, that looks pretty easy. I burnt, you know, butter one time, but like, sure, I could do it. And there's some like interest in that, right? So practicing that, I'm sure their first videos were awful, but like you get better, right? After the 1,000th video, you start finding your groove and actually using your analytics too to understand what went viral, what was a good click through, all that data now that is served up on these platforms, you don't have to be a data scientist to do. They give that to you now just automatically. So there's that instant feedback of like, hey, when I talk about, you know, speaking here, do people engage with that? Are they interested? Are they like, I never knew this about this university or these classes or whatever that looks like. So really think outside if you're doing media yourself of what your brand is, how you can have that shorter attention span, but pack a lot of punch in a, you know, a minute, 2 minutes. And then also storytelling. Everyone loves the like comeback. Everyone loves people that have gone over mountains or figured out how to get through to different careers. Obviously for me, it's hockey, a traditional sport, but for you, it could be a million different things. So find out what's your story, how to tell those nuggets of information, really backing up what you're trying to get to an audience. And then there's some ideas of like different ways you can lay out stats in sports. We provide these to a wide variety of clients, but I really think if you can visually then tell what you're saying, it's like the ultimate in giving a decision maker, giving an audience your overall conclusion to what you're trying to get at. Here's an example of ESPN. So usually I have some of my examples, but I wanted to throw in one that was on national TV so you understand all of the data and what the collection was beforehand, how that actually gets woven into a story.
Take a look and take a listen. We're going to run you through this. Watch. One timer, bam, gone. All right, now this one's off the draw. Watch the stick in behind them. Still able to sling it with a ton of torque. Bam, against Chicago. No big deal. Way behind him on this one, a la Mario Lemieux, still slings it for a goal. No big deal, not to be outdone. This one's out to a side, lateral. Still gets torque and beats Sorokin. Little forehand, backhand, forehand, and tight. And then here's tonight. The one from tonight. Wow. He absolutely salsas the D. Oh, my goodness. Patrick Laine. So that is a good sample size of what he can bring to the table, Callie.
And that's this heat map is great, Callie, about, again, as Weeksy mentioned, either side. Close, far, he has
a world-class shot, so it doesn't matter where he's shooting from. Yeah. And Weeksy pointed out great in that video, it could be in tight to his feet, it could be out wide. And the thing about him, he has that reach, right? So as a defender, it's hard. You think you're puck on stick with him. All of a sudden, you're puck on stick. His stick's out here. It's a quick move here. He's moving 4 feet when he's doing lateral. This here. And all of a sudden, he's moving lateral, and he can still shoot it just as hard here as he can out here. So as a defender, that's a nightmare to try to defend because you can shoot it out here, bar down, or you're shooting it right here, bar down.
And I think that's great to see, you know, the traditional media. So these gentlemen played in the NHL or have talked about hockey their whole life. Think like, analytics and data isn't for me, or technology isn't for me. And then you realize there's so many connections between what people see, how they understand the world, and that really our minds are computers, right? We're taking in data, we're taking in information, and we're trying to make sense of it. So it really made sense, especially in sports, to join that together where, you know, you can talk and they are excellent broadcasters. They know exactly what they're watching, but give them other layers that gives them really a depth of understanding to the audience that can encapsulate what they want to talk about and how they want to get it to. And for this, it was that heat map. So you saw that earlier example of, you know, a JSON file to data to this heat map, and it showed up in a broadcast. So pretty cool. I will skip past my example, but I will say that I am a big proponent of not only men's sports, but obviously supporting the women's side. I think that athletes have a parallel type of fight in terms of how they're treated and how women in business, women in tech, whatever sector you want are. And there's been some major breakthroughs in hockey where, you know, we just have a professional women's hockey league. There's a few in the U.S., Boston, New York, Minnesota. So if you want to pick a team now, that's perfectly fine. I tried to get a Seattle Kraken fan over here. So I always say, pick a team, learn the players, have fun. Sports is supposed to be fun. But for me, I was very passionate about supporting women athletes. I've done a project. Actually, I looked, my first pitch was 14 years ago to a league to work in women's hockey. And every year I make that checklist. And to me, it's not like it's, you know, something that I have to do. It's something that not only do I want to do, I think it's necessary for the growth of all the industries. And having that business mind of saying, you reach more fans, there's bigger demographics, and you're including more professional level athletes, why wouldn't you do it? So this was a visual I did for the Olympics. I was able actually to go to Korea, watch some of the finals. A little known tidbit too is it's typically one of the biggest televised finals in the Winter Olympics. One of their marquee events is US and Canada women's hockey. So that it drops off for the next 4 years to me, just like a head scratcher. It only made sense that there's this gigantic group that if you put the capital, you put them on national TV, the demand will come and the demand is already there. So it's wonderful to see them get off the ground and that these women can have careers and rightfully so have endorsements. I mean, Barbie, Canadian Tire, all these big brands are standing behind them and putting their money where their mouth is. And I think it's about time, not only in sports, but now you see more women executives. There was the first GM of the major sports teams in baseball, Kim Ng. And I think that was a watershed moment to realize that, hey, not including half the population probably isn't the best way to recruit. So anyone out there that's thinking, you know, it's hard to be in the medical field or fintech or entrepreneurship, you know, strike that from your mind. The time is now and people are looking for great people. So you could be next in line at any time. Another example of joining animation and DataViz. This, I'm not sure we'll play on that. So let's see if I can cue it up here. Just an example of like moving points of when the puck gets touched and where it's skated to. And then I have an overlay too for everyone who's thinking, is this all only about hockey? And maybe it is, but you're also in Utah. You might get a big hockey team, who knows? So it's a good primer to see how hockey is actually tracked in some of the events. So you can see here, trying to make it very simplistic. These are complicated metrics in some cases, but I think part of data and analytics is to teach others about what is most important, whether that's in your field or in sports. This is a continuous flow of a game. You can see this is a pass that's made, the length of a pass, where it's received, a negative maybe data point of a missed coverage coming up, and then an unsuccessful zone denial, so this team didn't do as well. And it ends in a shot. And actually, historically, the shot wouldn't have even been included in a data set. So it would have been lost forever had it not been tracked in certain ways because it didn't even hit the net. So historically, shots off net wouldn't have been included. But this was one of the most best shot quality or shot probability of scoring because it was a two-on-one, on-man rush, a lot of speed. Typically, that would be a great way to score, but that person would have never been credited for it. So I think like the emergence of data and tech allows a better understanding in all fields, especially sports. Now I might gloss over the technical side a little bit, but I wanted to throw in some shot quality, expected goals, talk a little bit about the technical nature just because I am in a university and it is kind of fun sometimes to do math. This is a couple years ago, the top expected goals for and against, meaning the goals that they created or the shot quality they created and the shot quality they prevented. And you can see when you look at the best teams, Colorado won a cup, Florida Panthers made the final, Calgary Flames are not doing so well, Tampa Bay made a final. So most of the best teams rise to the top with metrics that matter. And I think that's part of the gut check too, of when you're building different models, you're thinking of formulas, does this make sense if I give it to an industry expert? Will they buy into what I'm doing? Or is there something I have to go, are we missing some data? Are we misunderstanding what the end goal is? Same with shooting talent. I have a ton of people that say, well, if it's not shooter adjusted, do I understand what's going on? Because there's some people that just have that elite talent level. This is a great example of Patrick Laine versus an average shooter, where you see that heat map is where he can score from. That's showing where he scores from versus the average shooter. It's pretty easy to see Patrick Laine is elite. He has a great shot. He's tall, he's strong, he can score in a set goaltender. If I show you these two, you can be in, just not even know anything about hockey, but know that man can score. So there's ways to translate data and understand data deeper using shot quality, using different visualizations, and really connect with the end audience. Same with different types of data visualization. So here you can see the better shooters are at the top, the worst shooters are at the bottom, and how much they are. So Patrick Laine, the heat map I just showed you, he's right at the top. He's awesome. Kucherov also has an amazing shot, rightfully so. Tampa Bay Lightning, he's one of the final, like he'll be a front runner for the Hart Trophy, the best player in hockey this season. And then the other two, even though they're great players and they score maybe close to the net or at different times, they don't quite translate the same way when you're looking at shooter talent. So very easy to like conceptualize and compare players when you have a great depth of data, you have accurate data, and you can make some of these models. And then getting to more of expected goals too. So shot quality of a team, you can see where they score from. If you get a goaltender moving or other different areas, how that translates to your ability to score. So anytime you think of those variables when you're making models or looking at data analytics, you can see how some things can really change versus saying, hey, you're a coach, maybe try to get the goalie moving or cross ice passes are important or whatever field you're in or whatever you're working on. Very simple explanation before we get to some questions. I just wanted to go through, tie the expected goals technical side all together. and look at William Karlsson from 2018, 2019, you can see he had 26 goals and he was exactly on his shot quality. So he pretty much scored on all the shots he should have. When he shouldn't have scored, he didn't get them. Next season, 19 goals. So not as many goals, but still 29 expected goals. He actually had better shot quality. He was, you know, probably had harder shots, one-timers, getting closer to the net. Third year, only 19 goals still. His expected goals dropped a little bit. And you can see that in reality, the next year, he had more goals. So expected goals was more predictive for someone like William Karlsson than actual goals year over year. Same with thinking about context too. Hockey's a great game because you can sub people in and out. They play with different lines. So running advanced models to say, hey, what if I plug this player in with this line or an average line? How much do they contribute? So this is just an example of Shea Theodore, him with average line mates and him with five average skaters without him. So you're able to see like the differences and the deltas and who you may want to add to a roster, who you would take away and how that would impact that. So that was my 10 minutes on some of the technical side. I hope some people in here watch sports, consume sports analytics and wanted to hear a little bit about that. But I'm happy to talk about anything from my journey to what it is to be an entrepreneur, a woman in sports or tech, and any questions you have. Thank you very much for having me.
So we're gonna bring a microphone up here. If you have any questions, please come line up. I have a question for you though.
Sure.
Are we standing too close? I don't want to be that guy.
No.
All I know about hockey really is how impressive I think the Seattle Kraken are after our conversation. You used a couple terms that I think are that I would like defined as a non-hockey person.
Absolutely.
One is, what's a power play?
Oh, okay. Yeah. A power play is if you take a penalty, your team, whatever that is, it could be hooking, could it be tripping, you're penalized. So you have to go sit in this penalty box. Actually in Vegas, I don't know if anyone's Game of Thrones fan, they play like the shame when people go to the penalty box. It's quite fun. You get an extra skater. So the team has to play with four. You have still five players. And it's 2 minutes where you have an extra skater above the other team. So there's a lot of tactics. Power plays are fun. Special teams are fun in sports because there are specific times where you know it's probably going to be your top line that's out there as the power play unit.
And you bring the guy, people that you want out there.
Correct.
To be successful.
Yeah, you stack your lineup. So, yeah, that's a big time for teams.
So is there a single statistic that, like, what would be the most important statistic to look at as a team, for a team success or a player success?
I think probably the easiest are those expected goals against. So knowing how much shot quality you have, because you need to score more than you let in. Right. So knowing that you still play defense, that there's some differential where you're creating more than you're letting in. Because if you just look at like offense, you just say, OK, hey, skate with the puck. That often creates turnovers and allows a team to like come at you, have a lot of speed, score off the rush. So the nice thing about sports is there's never like this catch all. This is the only thing you can look at. It's always an evolving field. But I'd say if you take anything from this, calculating out like shot quality or how many chances you create. And how you create them and how dangerous your team is, both offensively and then preventing the dangerous chances, can give you a glimpse of, hey, are we doing a good process? Should I be a Seattle Kraken fan? Should I be a Vegas Golden Knights fan? Whatever you want to align with in Utah.
So anybody have questions? I don't want to be that guy.
Awesome.
But come on up.
It's always like the first person. Once we get one, we get rolling. So thank you.
Helen, I was just wondering, you talked a lot about being a woman in business and sports. What's been your most like defining hurdle that you've overcome with the challenges that come along with that?
Honestly, I think it's my own mindset. I think it's like very natural to have like imposter syndrome or think that there's people far more skilled than me, far more like, you know, 30, 40 years in the industry, what do I have to bring to the table? And especially as a woman, maybe going into rooms, there's so many rooms I've gone into, probably 95% of the time I'm without another woman. So for me, I see it twofold. I one see as an opportunity to show that anyone can contribute, but also that I have now the opportunity to bring other women in the room. And I've actively tried to build up my pipeline. So I always think every 2 years, how do I replace myself with people, including women, and bring more women into the room that are high skilled, that know that they add value, but always know that there's growth ahead, right? It's never the end. You can never know enough. And the industry, especially tech, changes so much that no one's an expert anymore, right? It's just, you're probably the experts at school now and on social media and certain things that are very new. So use that to your advantage too. Have the confidence of what you're doing right now is important. And don't feel like you'll ever, you know, have the question of why is that person here? You always have value.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Please come on up. You can stand up, line up, come up. I mean, we're talking about hockey, right? So be aggressive.
I do some other sports too. So if you do have questions about your favorite sports, go ahead. I'll answer them as well as I can.
Okay. My name's Riker.
Hi, Riker.
I have two questions. First one is, how do you kind of keep like a mentality, keep on pushing, like when you go down? I know you're talking about failure and stuff.
Yes.
Like you fail a lot. So how do you keep like a positive mentality?
Yeah, I think for me, it's just about, you know, being comfortable with that and knowing that it's not the end. And then also taking breaks. Like, I feel like when you're a student, especially, and when you go into the workforce, you think like, I just have to work so hard to keep up. And I really do think that whether it's sports, whether it's your career, it's a marathon, right? There's no like sprints in life. So giving yourself that time to say, hey, I didn't accomplish what I wanted to, but I'm going to take a couple weeks off, or I'm going to like go for a hike, or I'm going to like, you know, figure out how to enjoy life. Because I feel like the best, most passionate people that can bring that energy back, even after a failure, will achieve different goals, you know? So you may not achieve exactly what you wanted. Like I said, did I think I would be here standing in front of all of you? I mean, it's wonderful, don't get me wrong, but like, it was just something that I didn't even foresee. So I think the best thing about failure too is that it allows you to find a different path where you thrive in. So I just always try to take it in stride and think like, this is positive, you know, and I maybe dodged a bullet that I really didn't want that.
And then my second question is, I'm an Anaheim Ducks fan.
Oh no.
How do we fix anything that's going on right now?
It's tough.
Yeah.
I mean, you're kind of in a full rebuild.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great place to live. So I'm hopeful that you'll attract a good crop. There's a good young talent base. I think like drafting will be really important. Obviously there's been some changes there. So, I mean, you've won a cup, which is awesome. Some franchises can't say that at all. So enjoy that historical nature. And then also like the young players that are coming up and, you know, Trevor Zegras, and there's pieces there that should work together. It's just, you know, it's hard, right? Rebuilding is tough as a fan, but also for a GM, it's really hard.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello.
My name's Chance. I also have two questions as well.
Sure.
So how did you start with like the data and everything? Because you didn't advance to like greater models later on. How did you like start with the data?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I mean, part of it was starting in university, right? It took a lot of quantitative classes, had great professors, and really used what was in the university to my advantage. So made sure if any of like the courses overlapped what I wanted to achieve or what I was working on, whether that was like figuring out like sort of some engineering or like computer software, audited even classes that I thought, well, maybe this is a challenging one. It's outside of my like faculty. Maybe I, you know, don't necessarily need it, but I'm interested. Just building up that toolkit to do a lot, I think was really important. And yeah, I definitely had some professors that were like, what are you doing? These are so different in terms of like backgrounds. But I thought that was a really big ace of cards, because I came out knowing a lot about a lot of different areas and was able to like join them together or hire people. So that was sort of the second wave. One is like figuring out a prototype and scaling it yourself. And then second is about finding the people that you can hire and what those people look like. So without knowing what I was going to build, it's pretty hard to hire people. But once I got that conceptually with my co-founders, it was a lot easier to scale and know, like, maybe it's an engineer, maybe it's a physicist. Like, there's so many variables that go into, like, sports analytics, data science now. So being open to, like, what that looks like and not just having, like, a rigid idea of what a company should be.
And as for my second question, do you have a favorite statistical model?
Ooh, That's a good one. I mean, I do like expected threat. So there was a paper published at MIT Sloan by a gentleman at the time who was working for FC Barcelona, just valuing soccer because there's not a lot of goals in soccer, not even a lot of shots. So he was trying to place value on where the ball was moved and how that was moved and in what way. And I just thought that was really unique, but because typically it's like very like offensive models or some sort of actions. And this was like all conceptual of the entire game and all the game flow. So if you want to type in expected threat and look up that paper, it's pretty cool.
My name is Ben. What would be the best way to get like an internship with a company like yours?
That's a good question. And I mean, I think just start early, right? And if you're taking courses, like use that to your advantage too. So if there's a way to do a project, I know there's some like project classes where you can pick your own, find an open source data set. So I actually publish data as much as I can to do this Big Data Cup. This is our third time doing it, Big Data Cup 3. It's actually due tomorrow, so you might not want to submit, but like if you're interested, go download the data. I think the best thing to do as a student is don't tell people, show them, right? Have a sample of work, have a model you've made, have some visualization that you've done, and send it to them. And be you know, reach as many people as you want to. So go to conferences, you know, get emails, track people down that are hiring, not necessarily the bosses, but the people that are actually hiring interns, and connect with them and show them your work. So everyone's looking for great people. It's hard to find great people. And you sound like you're already passionate about it. So connect what you're doing at school with a real world experience and then get it in the right hands.
Thank you so much for coming. And my name is Sejun Liu. I teach hospitality classes here at SUU. So I like that you touched on the hospitality industry as well. So thank you for bringing that up. A couple of things that you talked about, including setting up the goals. And then I have a follow-up questions for you. When you're determined your goal in 2 years or a year or 5 years, how do you set the expectations for yourself? And how do you set expectations for the company in general?
Ooh, that's a great one. And I feel like those companies have workshops that are weeks and weeks to try to realign goals. I'd say personally too, I do those action items, right? It's one thing to say, I want to be here in 5 years, but what do those check-ins look like? Like, what's the real work? Because a lot of times the hard work is work that other candidates or other professors might gloss over. So publishing a lot of papers, you know, doing radio shows, getting in the news, whatever that checklist looks like for your industry, do like a work back schedule, right? And make sure that you're being honest with yourself of like, am I doing the work to hit my 5-year goal? And if you're not, use your mentorship network, right? In your case, it may be like other faculty members. In my case, it's like my mentors in like sport or that own other companies. I actually have a call with founders once a month and we run similar companies and we check in with each other. You know, are there things we can share? Are there problems that we didn't know about? Are there, you know, different movements in the market? So I think creating that network, especially as a student right now, if you're looking for mentors, that's someone that can help reflect on you and allow you to not only achieve those 5-year goals, maybe you can get there faster. Like that's the best case.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I feel like a lot of the things that you talked about, I can totally relate and it helped me too. So definitely it would be beneficial for the students here. Another thing that you touched on is more like learning while you're doing and then keeping the growth mindset. You're working towards your goals, especially in the tech industry. So what are you doing to keep yourself and the company relevant?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's something we're bringing in the right type of people too. I have major projects at different universities that's like their complete focus and goals. So allowing people who are looking outwards to kind of filter back to you and keep you not only relevant, but like pushing, like what more can we do? So my biggest question to people I work with is like, what are we not doing that we should have done yesterday? And how do I get you there? Whether that's more resources, whether that's more capital. And then also internally, are there ways to make our process better that maybe as we've grown, we have similar people doing similar roles where it can be like joined and like superpowered. So I think finding those like synergies both inside and outside. And I'm naturally like, I love being here because being in the classes here, all the students ask such great questions. You know, you grow that way too. So I love attending conferences. I like doing speeches. I like actually talking to people of all ages because I think all demographics are important. And a lot of people now are like really focused on Gen Z and really young people. So even having kids and seeing what they do and like, you know, there's some power in market research in that. So I think for everyone, it's like stay open to your surroundings and don't be afraid to like step out of your industry or out of your classroom and be a little uncomfortable or in a group that you're not usually in.
Well, thank you so much for your answers.
Thank you. And thank you so much and everyone else for helping me along in the last couple days.
Hi, I'm Jackie.
Hi, Jackie.
Love the talk. Love
thank you.
Talk. I just wanted to let you know first, we actually have had a hockey team here in Southern Utah in Cedar City with no ice for the past 6 years.
Oh, wow.
So there are hockey fans here and they're going to get an ice rink next year.
Amazing.
But my question for you is, how, as an introvert, did you get to the point where you like giving public talks?
Well, I found as an introvert, I loved meeting people. And that was sort of the connection for me of breaking down some of those walls. And I think it's just repetition too, right? It's, you realize even with media, with that clip, I look at media and I think, oh, they could have said that better or done that better. And you realize a lot of extroverts don't even look at their mistakes. They just sort of keep going and they improve and they get better. So knowing that no one's perfect, I will never be perfect. I'll never give the perfect talk. It's freeing, you know? And then I have the joy in meeting, connecting, doing wonderful things when I get to do talks as well. And that just sort of brings me full circle to like a growth moment versus saying, okay, I'm stressed. There's all these people looking at me. Maybe they don't like my topic or whatever that is. So I think just embracing that there's always two sides to the coin and what may be your strength is someone else's weakness. And that's okay.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
So you have one last question? Because if not, I do. Okay. So one, what is the most exciting thing about hockey right now?
Ooh, that's a great question. I mean, from my perspective, I think the most exciting thing is like the growth and emergence of like tech and analytics. I just think it makes sports so much more not only competitive to other industries, but allows people to like understand that have historically maybe not played, not engaged, or just, you know, kind of bypassed it. So I think if you haven't gone to an NHL, even a junior game in real life and saw like the competition, the speed, the skill, it's really cool to see up close. And it's, you know, definitely like an entertainment spectacle. I would say in hockey specifically, I mean, the Stanley Cup playoffs are coming up. I don't know if anyone likes playoff hockey. They're on ESPN. It's just awesome. TNT too, if anyone has cable, you can get them there. So do me a favor. Tune in just for one period, see if you like it, pick a team, can be any team. And you know, anyone can be a fan of sport. And I think it's just a microcosm of life, right? It's teamwork. You never win all the time. You never lose all the time. There's a lot of things to be learned from sport. So I think it's, yeah, it's fun for work, but it's also fun as like a fan and just like as an outlet.
Thank you. And finally, the playoffs are coming up, and then we're going to have some downtime, and then the season's going to start again.
Right.
Who should we be watching that we're not watching currently? What team should we be watching as it comes up? Certainly not the Anaheim Ducks, but what team should it be?
I think from this perspective of like, you know, you're in the Western Conference, you're in the West, so the ones on the best time zone for you are the Vegas Golden Knights that just won the Stanley Cup, the Colorado Avalanche that just made a couple trades, couple moves that have made themselves stronger. The Vancouver Canucks out there too. They skate hard. They've been very skilled this season. It's been really awesome to see. And then lastly, the Edmonton Oilers, who have one of the best athletes in the world, Connor McDavid. So if you can tune into an Oilers game, he can skate like no other. So there's four teams. You're in the West. It's on your time zone. Enjoy.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.